privilege to be one of the leaders for the Savannah Institute, the host of this event, and I want to start just by thanking all of you so much for being here. This event is really about the people who are here, and hopefully we're doing our job to provide a space for all of you to exchange with each other. So that's what we're all about. I want to start by doing thank yous because this, even though I'm the one standing up here, that's just because if things go wrong, it's my fault. But there's a lot of people who have helped things go right. First and foremost, I want to thank Christy, who many of you have met, and she's been the lead organizer for this whole gathering, and it couldn't have happened without her. So if you see Christy, tell her thank you. It's been invaluable for her to be a part of this team of Savannah Institute. I want to also thank Greenlands Blue Waters. That was for those of you who are not a part of that conference, the session that we watched on video just before this was a part of the Greenlands Blue Waters conference. And so we've co-sponsored and shared some sessions with our gatherings, respective gatherings this year. And so far I think it's been a wonderful mutual benefit. And I'm really grateful to the co-organizers of that event that we were able to do that. So thanks to all the folks affiliated with Greenlands Blue Waters. And the Center for Integrated Agricultural Systems at the University of Wisconsin was the lead organizer this year for that conference. So thank you to them as well. We have a wonderful array of sponsors this year, which is something that we haven't really done for this gathering previously. And so a deep thanks to those sponsors that have really made it possible for us to do this and to try to keep the conference affordable for all of you. And I've started to say the word conference despite myself. I've really avoided that because I don't really like conference so much. And we're not professional conference planners, if you haven't noticed. So please do bear with us in that we're kind of learning as we go what it takes to bring a lot of people together to share with each other. But we have had sponsors to help us with that, and I want to especially thank Forest Keeling Nursery. Lupe is here as a representative of them, and they have a display over here, as well as the Wisconsin Farmers Union also has a table over here, supported us greatly. And there are a number of people here as well from the Center for Humans and Nature, and so we thank them for being here and for their support. And then we've had a lot of support from farmers and food providers, which has been a really excellent part because that's what we're all about here. And so I want to thank Nesala Kombucha. And I'm feeling a little jittery maybe because of the kombucha that I drank this morning. It could just be because I'm standing up here too. But thanks to them. We're very thankful to Steve Brew and Mark and some of his family members have provided the coffee for us here. So thanks to them for that. Turkey Ridge Organic Apple Orchard, which is just up the hill from where I grew up, provided the wonderful organic apple cider here. And Autumn Berry Inspired from Dustin Kelly, who's one of the Savannah Institute board members, makes a delicious jam, jelly, and other products from an otherwise invasive shrub, and he's found a way to make something delicious out of it. So thank you, Dustin, for supporting us with the jam this year. And thanks to Norm Erickson for bringing hazelnuts from Minnesota that we'll be enjoying with our lunch or dinner today, with dinner. And thanks to Underground Catering. Those of you in town from this area know that Underground are purveyors of some of the finest food around. They have a number of restaurants in the area and caterers, and very thoughtful sourcing of their food and preparation as well. So we're very glad they were willing to prepare the food for us today as well, the lunch and the dinner. I want to thank the Lucier Center here, the facility where we're at. And as you can see, it's a beautiful place. It's a part of Dane County Parks and 1,000 acres of open land that we're surrounded by here. I was told that when they built this building in the excavation, they found many, many arrowheads. And so this is a place that people have found a good place to be for a long time. And so I want to extend our thanks to the people who came before us here as well. And I'm told there are effigy mounds not too far away from here as well. So people mark this as a special place as well. I want to give a thank to our speakers and our panelists today. We're going to get to you all soon here, but thank you so much for being here. And you all will have the opportunity this afternoon to be speakers as well. And so I really want to thank you again for being here. That's what the heart and soul of this gathering is. Started 5 years ago with a kitchen full of a few farmers. And in the grand scheme of things, we're still just a kitchen full of a few farmers. But I think that's, from what we've heard this morning and from what we all know in our hearts, that's what we need going forward, is to be in the kitchen together and out in the fields. So without me spinning my wheels any further, I want to get into this panel, because one of the things that I thought was a tremendous opportunity with having Greenlands Blue Waters team up with us is that it's a gathering that attracts people from all different walks of what makes agriculture happen. People who are the farmers themselves, part of farmers' organizations, people who work for government agencies, people who work for nonprofits and businesses and lead those entities, and folks in the academic world as well. And so finding a way for us all to come together, and we're not all gonna have exactly the same vision, but if we can find where our vision aligns and then figure out what do we need to do together to get there, that's really what I'm hoping that this panel can do. And I should note right off that the panel as well is a collaboration with the Mid-American Agroforestry Working Group, otherwise known as MAWG, which is kind of a mouthful, but it's a group that has existed for a number of years that includes people who are working on agroforestry throughout the Mid-American region. And MAWG is a part of the Greenlands Blue Waters Partnership. And so this session is the agroforestry breakout session of the Greenlands Blue Waters Group, in addition to being our Savannah Institute gathering. And so if you'd like to become more involved with the Mid-American Agroforestry Working Group, Mike, who's on our panel, is very involved with that. And Jerry Neal, if you can raise your hand in the back, has also been a ringleader for the MAWG group. And so that's an opportunity that we have, too, is to see what can the MAWG group be in this whole universe of how we're working together to advance agroforestry. So I want to just give a very short, what is agroforestry, because I don't want to assume that everybody knows. Essentially, it's trees on farms, and trees that are on those farms for very intentional purposes and are managed to achieve those purposes. When trees are not in a place that's intentional or are not managed for a purpose, then we call plants that are in the wrong place on farms weeds, and trees can be very big weeds. And I think that's why trees have a bad name among a lot of farmers, to be honest. So agroforestry is trying to find, instead of just seeing trees as these big weeds, these big problems, how can we use trees? How can trees be a part of working farms and be solutions for the problems on farms? So that's what agroforestry is. It's the practice and science of doing that. While we have a lot of good science and a lot of good examples of practice, you don't have to drive far through the Midwest to see that it hasn't gotten very far. And so we can speculate on why that is, what the history is, and what the circumstances and reasons are that it hasn't got very far. But I think we only really do ourselves a favor when we do that to the extent to see how can it move us forward into a future where there are more trees in the landscapes accomplishing all the many things that they can. So that's what this panel is a focus on the future to say, how can we advance agroforestry in the heartland? And the heartland is meant to be a little bit of a play on words to say that is our region, what it's known as, otherwise known as the flyover states. But the heartland is also to say, as Jacob gave a great talk this morning, to say, it's also what happens from person to person and within people to move agroforestry forward. So I invite our panelists to discuss that in whichever way they think is most helpful. So the prompt that I've given to the panelists is to speak on this topic of how do we advance agroforestry in the heartland, and specifically to articulate a vision of where are we going. And then let's see where those visions align and what are the avenues for realizing those visions and what are the promising partnerships to make that happen. And so the way that I've structured the panel is, and I should say not just me, but folks from the Mid-American Working Group and Greenlands Blue Waters that we work together to put together this panel, is to give each of our panelists a very brief beginning, modeled somewhat after our nutshell talks, where it's 5 minutes for them to essentially condense and synthesize what is that vision and what do they see as the, the key opportunities and limitations. And then when they've all had a chance to do that, we'll open it up to you. And we'll take a batch of a few questions at a time. And as the questions are being asked, you panelists can take note of which of those questions you'd like to respond to. And then we'll give each of the panelists an opportunity to respond. So it'll take a little bit of back and forth to have a conversation that's meaningful and purposeful among this many people, but hopefully we can make it happen. And so the last thing that I want to do before we get going is to introduce the panelists to you. And even though it's going to be a lot, I think it's best if I do that all at once, and then instead of interrupting between the panelists so that you can hear their visions one after the other. I'm not sure about that. Do you panelists have a preference? Okay, so we'll do all the bios all at once. And bios are always a little bit uncomfortable because people don't like to hear about themselves and that sort of thing, but I think it is helpful for you to know who's speaking with you today, because I think it is a really excellent lineup that we have. So, and I have them kind of spread through here, but I'll try to go down the line. So on the left here is Reginaldo, or Rehi Haslet Marroquin. He's the Chief Strategy Officer at the Main Street Project, and essentially he's the principal architect of their innovative poultry-centered regenerative agriculture model, and I think you'll hear more about that. So his focus is on the development of multi-level strategies for building regenerative food and agriculture systems that deliver social, economic, and ecological benefits. He leads the engineering and design work at Main Street and oversees the implementation of the blueprints for these projects with communities in the U.S., Mexico, Guatemala, and Honduras. And Dave Miller, next in line here, is the co-founder and CEO of Iroquois Valley Farms. This is rooted by heritage in Iroquois County, Illinois. David returned from his returned to his native farming community in 2005 after a 30-year career in banking and real estate financial management. Purchasing a small 10-acre family farmstead, he reconnected with local relatives farming organically. And in 2007, he started Iroquois Valley Farms, LLC, by connecting a small group of family and friends to a 142-acre farm. So I hope Dave will be telling us more about his work with Iroquois Valley Farms and what they're doing. Next is Kate McFarland, who is the assistant agroforester at the U.S. Forest Service and USDA National Agroforestry Center. Kate's been with the U.S. Forest Service since 2011, and prior to that, she worked for the Ecosystem Workforce Program at the University of Oregon and with the U.S. Peace Corps in Senegal and in a variety of other positions related to natural resource management and agriculture. Lindsay Rephan, next on our panel, is a partner, designer, and project manager and nursery woman at Ecological Design, which is based out of Minneapolis. Lindsay designs permaculture systems from tiny urban lots to broadacre farms. Since 2005, she's worked with Ecological Design on designing, implementing, and managing integrated, edible, working landscapes. Next, Tom Wall is here from Redfern Farm in Iowa. Tom was born and raised in Iowa and graduated from Iowa State University with a degree in fisheries and wildlife biology. He worked for 16 years in various government agencies and wildlife, and now he and his wife Kathy bought a farm in Louisa County in 1986. Tom became full-time on the farm in 2001, where he and his wife Kathy grow high-value tree crops, including chestnuts, heartnuts, persimmons, pawpaws, and several other crops, as well as operating a small tree nursery. Mike Gold is next. Mike is a forestry professor and the interim director at the University of Missouri Center for Agroforestry. Mike was a founding member and first president of the Association for Temperate Agroforestry, known as AFTA to some of you. He's worked in both temperate and tropical agroforestry for the past 30 plus years. His current research focuses on the development of market and consumer knowledge for specialty crops such as chestnut, elderberry, and pawpaw. Mike also teaches an agroforestry course in the online Master of Science degree in Agroforestry at the University of Missouri, and he's been active in the outreach and training programs there over the past 19 years. And last but not least, Sarah Taylor Lovell. here from the University of Illinois, where she's an associate professor of landscape agroecology in the Department of Crop Sciences. With a background in agronomy and landscape architecture, Sarah's research program focuses on the design and performance of multifunctional landscapes. She serves as the lead investigator on a long-term agroforestry field trial, the multifunctional woody polyculture trial, and where they're studying the relationship between the structure and function of this agroforestry system. So once again, I want to thank each of you very much for being here. I'm going to be somewhat strict on our 5-minute limit, so I'll give you a 2-minute warning and a 1-minute warning, and then I'll stand up when the 5 minutes is up, if that sounds okay. Mm-hmm. And I thought that maybe we'll start down, does anyone in particular want to start? Probably not. Well, I made one promise to Dave that he wouldn't be near the beginning, so I want to honor that. And so, Sarah, would you be willing to go first?
Sure. Great. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I have one note, Alexa, so I should be short. I will be brief, actually. So, we were, asked to kind of talk a little bit about our vision.
Sarah, maybe you want to stand up so people in the back can see you.
Yeah. Talk a little bit about our vision for agroforestry. And in the introduction, Keith told you a little bit about the project, the long-term, large-scale agroforestry trial that we have out. It's a trial that's really focused on an alley cropping type of system. But what's unique about it, I guess, is that in a lot of alley cropping systems, they focused on using trees that are mostly timber species. And in our trial, we're really focused on fruit and nut producing species within those rows. So that's one unique aspect of it. Therefore, we go with the name, instead of the multifunctional woody polyculture, we more affectionately call it the Agroforestry for Food project. So that's one aspect that's unique. The other is that we're really focused on the real polyculture aspect and a lot of diversity within those rows of different species and that multi-layer structure that reflects some of the needs of permaculture. So we have treatments that range from almost like an orchard style system all the way up to a very diverse system that has, I think, 9 different species in that treatment. So I'm very interested in that aspect, but that may be a little bit more extreme than what I see for the really early vision of agroforestry. As you can imagine, I'm in a Department of Crop Sciences at University of Illinois in Central Illinois, so I'm an outlier about as far out as you can possibly imagine within my department. So I have to kind of justify my existence a little bit and how it relates to things that are going on. I'd like to propose that we just replace all the corn and soybeans with agroforestry. I'd be totally good with that, but probably wouldn't go down too well in the department. So the vision that I have kind of for the near term is really looking at the marginal lands in the areas that we're in. And when we talk about marginal lands in Central Illinois, we're talking about land that's actually still pretty darn productive, but somewhat less productive than the best parts of the farm. So we can look, you know, farmers have yield monitors now. They have very, very precise, accurate data on what's going on within their fields. They can identify the parts of the farms that aren't as productive. And there are parts of their, you know, small portions of their farms that where they're really not even getting any economic benefit from doing corn soybeans. So we can look at those types of areas and say, would that be a good area to transition to some sort of agroforestry system? The other thing is areas that kind of irregularly shaped fields that are maybe shaped oddly because of a stream that goes through them or a roadway or something like that. So as farmers' equipment gets much larger, I'm sure a lot of you that live in the Midwest have seen just the very, very wide equipment that goes through for planting and harvesting and spraying. And so it becomes harder and harder for farmers to get into these smaller fields and actually do typical corn and soybean production. So I think those areas would be great ones, and through GIS we can help identify where those parcels are located and suggest some agroforestry practices for that. And then finally, I see some really great compatibility with some of the government programs, including the CRP program. So we're really interested right now in looking at something like the windbreak program, which typically is gonna be, you know, four rows of trees and shrubs, maybe a row or two of evergreens, a row of deciduous trees, and a row of shrubs. And right now there's no particular emphasis one way or the other on whether or not those are edible species at all. But we're looking at some of the native edible options that could be planted into those. And even though farmers couldn't take the harvest from that and try to sell it, because that's outside of the contract, it could still, being in that contract for a 10 or 15 year period, could provide that time period until those plants are even more productive. So I think that's a really great opportunity and something that several of us are already doing. And that's completely acceptable, particularly if you're looking at native crops that could go in there. And we're talking about things like elderberry and aronia and persimmon and pawpaw. So a lot of nice different options in that. So I think some good opportunities there.
Mike?
Delighted to be here. Just a couple things that I want to touch on in terms of the future. Having worked in agroforestry for a couple decades, I've had the opportunity to begin to see a lot of really positive changes that needed to occur for agroforestry to take off. So as an example, something that the Center for Agroforestry works on and many others around the Midwest is developing the science behind the practice, kind of what Sarah was talking about. So one of the things that's necessary if you're a landowner and you want to work in agroforestry is to try to have as much risk reduction as possible when you're going to go forward. So for example, if you want to plant chestnut, you need to know what's the right cultivar for the right geography, for the right market, and you need to know what to plant, how to manage, how to harvest, what the markets are, and the financial information. So that kind of whole suite of information is beginning to be developed for a number of different crops. There are now co-ops and other entities that are working on aronia or hazelnut or chestnut or elderberry, and these things didn't exist 10 years ago or 15 years ago. So we're getting to a point where as a landowner you're going to have a lot more confidence in your ability to move forward, and I think that's a real important sort of launch point for the future for agroforestry. Another thing that's really important is education, because unlike commodity agriculture, which has a gigantic support structure, agroforestry support structure is fairly small and just developing. So many of you in this room, many of us that work in MAUG and in agroforestry, we are creating our own knowledge network. We're learning together, we're sharing information together. And as that develops, that will also really help us move forward in agroforestry. And one of the things that Jacob Marty, I thought his talk was wonderful, I enjoyed it a lot. And he said, you know, my father ought to be out there because he's a community leader, and when he speaks to his peers, they respect him and they listen. So one of the things that's needed down the road or agroforestry are the same kind of agroforestry farmer champions. So people who are practicing agroforestry, respected in the community, that really can serve as the individuals who can reach out to their peers and have a lot of respect, so therefore there's a lot of these barriers are gone right away. So if we can have a good information sharing, and if we work from the high-tech science to the bottom up, farmer to farmer, which I see is happening. Savannah Institute is a key cog in this whole thing. Then I think we're gonna have success going forward in the future.
On our farm, 86 acres, we have pretty much every conceivable fruit and nut tree, shrub, and vine that can possibly grow in zone 5 climate that we at least tried them all. This is probably a rare group where there might be somebody in this room who could name something that we haven't tried. It's been several years since anyone, I give people this challenge, and it's been several years since anyone has been able to name something we haven't tried. Not all of these things are ready for prime time. Some of them probably never will be, commercial crops, but, and there's one that stands out way above all the rest, and that's the chestnut. It's in a class all by itself in terms of a crop. And our goal has always been to provide an example for alternative agriculture, where perennial plants integrated in a multi-species system can be the most profitable part of a farm, not just in odd corners or on marginal land, but on the very best land possible. And we've been successful in spreading that message, and this is totally without a budget or without institutional support. I think we're well over 100 farms in Iowa now that are at least in part modeling what we've been doing for the last 25 years. The point is, if you provide the right message, you can get acceptance of agroforestry. I think I'll leave it at that.
What do you really think, Tom? That was the optimistic version. Question and answer.
Yeah. Well, what I really think is it is far exceeded my wildest expectations.
Hi, Lindsay Raban, Ecological Design, and my vision. So I've had the opportunity, our company is based out of Minnesota and Wisconsin, specializing in the upper Midwest. We currently work with farmers in Iowa and Illinois and North Dakota as well. And I've been able to see the changes over the last 12 years, especially, and also the increase in the problems. And so my vision is larger, is following Minnesota to Texas, following the river down. What I see is a lack of skilled agrarians, and I see a lot of toxic poisoning, and so therefore lack of pollinators. So my particular niche that I've honed in on is transitioning corn and bean farmers over to reestablishing the soil, water, and fertility cycles. Optimistic as far as how fast we're able to change the soils, how much more carbon we're able to sequester by bringing the soil alive is amazing, and so I have a lot of hope with that. And I also have a lot of hope with being able to compound the diversity in the hubs. So in the hubs of the farmers, what we see is when we start working with an area, then those farmers kind of start getting a hub in their area. So if we can connect these hubs, these regenerative regional hubs from Minnesota to Texas along the Mississippi watershed, following oak savanna design with agroforestry, including riparian buffers, not just trees, and also bringing back the mycelium in biological soils, we're seeing really quickly toxins being remediated out of the soils, healthier food, more nutrient-dense food. I'm not, I'm a big fan of annuals. I eat them every day. And so obviously we're integrating annuals. And that's one of the other things that we've been able to leverage is figuring out whether you're a young farmer or you're an older farmer that's gonna transition your land, what are the quickest leverage points to get you into perennializing your landscape and bringing back the fertility cycle? Not everyone's gonna be able to bring on a herd of cows, but there's other options. And then the financial way also that's very exciting to me that we're starting to see patterns emerge is the diversity of partnerships, which you'll hear a little bit more about with some of the other panelists, but Minnesota's starting to experiment with things like flexible easements, where they pay you to not grow corn and soy. You can grow everything else but corn and soy and still get paid like you would in a natural conservation easement. So we're starting to see an example like that where the establishment phase, the investment phase in the beginning for perennial farmers is one of the hardest things to do to get over usually, if you've already got the land to start with. And so some of these other kind of alternative investments, either because they care about the water or because they care about healthy farming, they're starting to increase in different kinds of investors. So the economic piece of diversity is also growing. And then I guess I mentioned the training, but just the training is so important. So many people forgot, or at least one generation separated usually, from farming knowledge. And so then a lot of safety issues and other things come up as far as running machinery and large animals. So being able to hone in on these hubs, our favorite, the greatest, the you know, maybe a bigger size farm that can start training hundreds and hundreds of farmers at a time, and that through watershed boundaries, not political boundaries or property boundaries, that we can be managing other people's lands who may not be able to run cows, but they're gonna let us run animals through their property in some form of exchange. And so by utilizing watershed maps and property boundaries, we're able to expand a lot of the economic hurdles that were there before and be able to regenerate the land faster. So there's a lot of optimistic patterns that I'm starting to see, but I'm concerned about the land transition in the United States, the average age of the farmer, and 500 million acres transitioning in 20 years, and who's gonna own that land, and how is that land gonna be farmed? So we have a lot of work to do.
So I think like a lot of folks on this panel, I'm also pretty optimistic and excited about the possibilities, especially when we sort of, as Sarah was saying, when we look across the whole range of practices and approaches to agroforestry, rather than having a pretty narrow version of what it is, but really thinking about how can all of these perennial systems be integrated into such a wide range of farms and sort of the different gradients of agroforestry and really exploring all the way across those different gradients. I also am excited. I see a lot of opportunities when we look at some of the challenges that are facing all of agriculture around access to markets, access to capital, access to land, and risk management, as well as, you know, these environmental challenges that come up again and again when we're about agriculture in water quality challenges, climate change challenges, all of this. When I think about agroforestry, I don't think it's a silver bullet. I don't think it solves everything, but it's exciting to see some solutions wrapped up in those questions around managing risk, those questions around climate change in agroforestry. And so the more that we can sort of integrate agroforestry into how we're talking about agriculture, the better, I think. Another really key opportunity that I'm hoping we'll explore in this panel and throughout these couple of days is just the importance of partnerships. And maybe I feel this way because at the National Agroforestry Center, we're very small, we have very few staff, and we're covering the whole country, and everything we do is through partnership. But I think there's a lot of opportunity there for agroforestry to really, there's a tendency within agroforestry to sort of complain about the siloing of agriculture and the siloing of forestry. And I think we have to be really intentional to not create another silo in agroforestry, to make sure that we're avoiding that through not getting into that through language or through practices or just through that culture of wanting that silver bullet. And so I think I'm really excited to talk more about how we can avoid that in our partnerships. So I think making those partnerships with the rest of agriculture to really have nuanced conversations about how agroforestry fits into cover cropping, how agroforestry fits into nutrient management plans, and all of that. And you know, the last couple days, for those of us who have been at Greenlands Blue Waters, it's been a great opportunity for that. But I think we need to continue those conversations at a whole range of different scales. And so rather than saying just we need more partnerships, we really think about what those can look like. When are we working together? When are we working in parallel and coming together to share results? When are we just keeping each other informed? I think there's a lot of space there, and it's exciting. And especially since there aren't huge numbers of us involved in agroforestry, it's growing every single day, but there's not huge numbers. I think we can really take advantage of what we do best. It's really exciting to see nonprofits like the Savannah Institute and many others that are really able to be a lot more flexible, a lot more responsive to what ag looks like in different places. Than the federal government is ever going to be, right? So how do we take advantage of the institutional roles that universities provide, that private industry provides, that farmers provide, to really take advantage of what we're each doing, so we're really working to complement each other rather than everybody trying to provide everything. So I'm excited to talk through those partnerships over the next few days.
My name is David Miller. I'm the CEO of Iroquois Valley Farmland REIT. which I'll explain in a minute. But in 2005, while I was attending my Uncle George's funeral service, I decided that his farm should stay in the family, and purchased a small 10-acre farm. And my wife was very upset with me because she knew I didn't know anything about farming. I knew a little bit about finance, and I said, well, just bear with me here, you know, for a few years, and let's see what develops with this investment. So flashing forward, since 2005, Iroquois Valley is now a 50 farm plus or minus real estate investment trust, which has investors in 40 plus states, which has never sold a farm to anybody but back to the farmer. So we're a secure land access for what I see here is the revolution, you know, to erode the monoculture. I like to say I'm a baby of the monoculture. I was raised in north central Illinois, surrounded by corn and soybeans, or what we typically call the dead soil monoculture. So I realize I'm preaching to the choir here, which is fun. I think that I may be the only sort of finance capital person here, but we like to say that it is harder to train and transition an investor to put their money, invest their money in the right way, than it is for farmers to transition the land. And so we work very hard at that. In fact, I sometimes say I'm in the extractive business, which tends to open everybody's eye, you know, because that's usually negative. But the extraction is capital from my generation and transitioning that capital to the next generation, which has to happen for this macro change to take place in agriculture. And we see it as an unstoppable force. Tell you there's a whole new world of financial advisors out there that are teaching their clients to think long term, to invest for the long term, to invest in healthy investments. So that is happening just in time as this great need for capital really has to be being put into the next generation of farmers. And so that's exciting. That's a reason to be optimistic. I was in San Diego a couple weeks ago attending Responsible Investing Conference, and it was just flooded with people, and a lot of young people were there. So this is happening, and it's good news. So we extract capital for good reasons. 70% of our tenants within Iroquois Valley are millennials. So we really see the next generation, and that's where the money's going. They're not necessarily startup, you know. Often, most of these are family farmers, and it's the next generation. I listened to Jacob talk too, and yeah, old farmers rarely change, but they do pass away eventually. that's life, and that's death, and that's how I got started. Frankly, was, you know, my uncle passing away, and I don't know that this would have all happened if that didn't happen. So, but that change is happening more and more, and that's not a bad change considering where we are here in, you know, in the heartland. We see the change happening in three phases. I talked about farmers because that's mostly where we work. But the first phase is mostly for our farmers to go organic, and that's a struggle. Often they lose money, so, you know, it's a challenge to get them through that first phase. The second phase is more stabilization of their business plan and diversification, the beginnings of diversification. Now that you sort of made it, now what are you going to do, and how can you make more money, and et cetera, et cetera. And then the final phase, really, as I see, and we're just getting there, we're in our 11th season, but now we're seeing that infrastructure building. And so the infrastructure, you know, is, let's say it's fencing, or it could be a flour mill, you know, organic flour mill for processing more specialty and local production, you know, or it could be a chicken house, or it might be, you know, livestock in general. So that we see as the inevitable evolution of this change of the monoculture is continued diversity, and that all has to be supported with very, very long-term capital, and that's where I spend a lot of my time.
I'm Rick Hinaldo, I'm with Main Street Project, and I gotta tell you that my vision of agroforestry isn't really mine. I am but a little spot in a multi-generational process in from Guatemala, where we grew up, and doing agroforestry mostly because that was the only thing we could afford, but also because when we learn about conventional agriculture, and my dad did the numbers, they didn't add up, and we stayed with agroforestry. So I gotta say to you that I came into this because it simply makes more business sense than conventional agriculture. That, you know, if we want to talk about how the Midwest can go completely this way, let's make the business case, and you'll see how the industry is gonna have to run for its money, because it doesn't make sense to have corn and soybeans, especially in the Midwest. But more than that, in order to develop industries that are not conventional, one has to be very, very specialized. You can't develop industries doing a little bit of everything. It never happened before, and it won't happen. It's one of the reasons we're not succeeding at non-conventional cultures, because we haven't yet specialized. Now, within that, we can't reduce. Reductionism is one thing. Specializing is a very different concept. So we focused on picking up one livestock. No regeneration happens on a farm without a source of inoculation, both microbiological, both fungus and bacteria on a ratio of about 70% to 30%. So 70% fungi, 30% bacteria. That is a well-established scientific fact globally. Now, because we are coming in from a scalability standpoint, I wasn't coming in to design a farm, I was coming in to design new industries. Because of that, we picked the poultry industry. Because if with the poultry industry as an entry point, we can actually create a massive disruption of most of the different sectors of the industrial system. And at the same time, build an alternative way to replace one of the largest sources of food in this country, and one of the largest sources of exploitation of people, pollution, and one of the most aggressively vertically integrated industries in the world. So that's where poultry came in. So our vision is really a poultry-centered regenerative design to deploy new industries that reflect a holistic integrated agroforestry system designed for standardization, management, evaluation, tracking, and rapid scalability. That's what we came in to do. Now, how are we doing this? We're doing that by building partnerships with organizations that think at and act at system levels. We're not interested in partnering with organizations that see farms as their end goal, meaning projects. Farms are critical, but if they're not aligned as part of an industrial design, they end up as farms, and most of the time, most of the new farmers are failing because there is no system, infrastructure, and so on to support them, not because they don't know what they are doing. The other thing is that we build, we mold on the basis of project level design, but we design that for large scale application and aggregation so that one, farmers can adopt this system and then bring it to their farm rather than the other way around. You can't build systems out of all the different ideas that farmers are deploying. And so because of that, poultry for us was critical in the context of bringing in an easy, rapid turnaround, low level entry barriers and all of that. And the result was amazing. I started all of this in a 1.9 acre piece of land that I was able to buy, of which only 0.8 acres could be put into this system. We incorporated hazelnuts as the agroforestry covered, elderberries combined with elderberries, and then oaks and other species that are native to the big woods. With that system, we were able to gross $44,000 out of 0.8 acres in 2011, growing poultry under that canopy and creating some of the most amazing and more better tasting and low labor, low intensity poultry. With that, we moved on to designing then the larger scale system. Up to this point, we have 100 acres that we just secured, and Iroquois Valley Farms are critical to acquiring 40 of those 100 acres. We're scaling up to that and also deploy three other farms. One of them is 40 acres, the other is 15, and the other one is 4 acres. Bottom line is, we start with a model of 1.5 acres, that can produce around $47,000 per acre. And then that's for meat birds, and then for eggs, we use a 2.5 acre blueprint, and we move that into approximately $137,000 worth of gross income with egg production. That blueprint allows us to then make the business case for the larger scale deployment. So that's what we are working on.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, each of you. This is tremendous. So now what I'd like to do is get questions and input from you all. And the way that we'd like to try this is to hear from a batch of you, say maybe four or five, and panelists, we're really putting you to work here. It's your job to pay attention and think about if you, maybe you don't want to respond to all of those questions. There's plenty of you here. But think about who you want to respond to and how, and then we'll go through again and give everybody a chance to respond after we've done a batch of questions. Maybe I could see hands of who would like to ask a question. Okay, one, two, a couple more, three, four, five. Okay, so let's do those five to start with.
Thank you. Interested to know more about the finance end of it. And I overheard people say that there need to be profits for all the sectors, human and otherwise. So maybe Mr. Miller.
Thanks to you all for speaking and being here today. I'm interested in the kind of chicken and the egg problem of specializing and focusing on something that you can make economically feasible and also still being in the stage of developing these industries and not having good support networks existing.
Support network's a good segue for mine, and it's a strategic question. We talked a little bit about, I don't want to say marginalization of this kind of strategy, but you know, working within crop production and conventional ag and talking about governmental programming. I'm southeastern Indiana, and so this isn't really happening for us. So partnering with NRCS or Soil and Water, what kind of strategies do you have to recommend educating those who have the power to help you financially on your farm?
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about bridging that gap between agriculture and forestry. Right now we have a very distinct agriculture section and a very distinct forestry section with a lot of support for each, both through the government and through private industry. So what potential do you see for privatization of agroforestry and finding a way that embraces the cooperative nature of agroforestry while also really establishing something to combat these big sectors of agriculture and forestry, which agroforestry like it.
I was mainly curious to know more about the mechanics of the business model of a real estate investment trust and like where the different players are, from investor to farmer to the land itself, who owns that and how that all works, and then financially how returns are distributed.
It's like a whole bag.
Yeah, so you can pick which ones you'd like to respond to there, or you can wait till the next round. We'll do a few rounds of these.
Okay, figure out which ones I want to address. So I definitely appreciate the issue about specializing, the whole kind of chicken and egg thing, and recognizing that we're in the research realm in particular, we're kind of having to commit to some certain crops, not having really any idea where the markets are going to be. And so it's really hard to get growers to commit to something that's not even going to be productive for several years and the markets aren't there. But yet yet the markets can't develop until they know there's enough crop there. So I very much appreciate that, and I guess the recommendation there, I don't really have a strong recommendation other than diversifying, and I do think that focusing on crops that have like specialty values that aren't going to go away, like the high antioxidant crops like aronia and elderberry, I don't see the human health impacts issue decreasing at all. I see that, I don't see how that trend will go down. I see that being an increasing trend for many years to come. So I think if we focus on those aspects, like really looking at those crops and thinking about what their future potential is in terms of human health benefits, basically. So I think, you know, that might be a good strategy there. The question about strategies for kind of educating people at the NRCS offices and other agencies, I guess, you know, that's definitely a challenge, and that's, I think, something that we all need to work at together. And one thing I've heard kind of from other people is that in many of these offices, they need to hear from the landowners first. So those can be somewhat driven from the ground up, where the landowners need to go in there and say, I need to know more about this, and I want your, tell me where agroforestry can fit into your programs, and can we have some sort of sub-award that goes toward agroforestry. So the more the landowners are going in there and encouraging their neighbors to also go in there, the more pressure is going to be on them to have to come up with an answer. And then once there are options, like with the, say like the CRP Windbreak program, once you've kind of figured out you could put that habitat on there, it's been approved or whatever, then, you know, talking to experts or even doing your own little bit of research on trying to identify the species that would actually fit in that program. Still fitting with all the requirements that they have in terms of, you know, the rows of evergreens, the rows of deciduous, the rows of trees, and the rows of shrubs, but showing, you know, here's my list of species that they're natives, but they also have edible fruits and nuts. And just kind of getting that approved and then, you know, going ahead and starting to look at that option. And yeah, that I probably covered now, but bridging the gap between agriculture and agroforestry is definitely a challenge. I think one of the things that we're going to have to look at is kind of unusual tenure arrangements. So as farmers are aging, they probably aren't going to have the energy or interest in trying to integrate agroforestry maybe on their properties themselves, but they might be kind of looking at a longer vision of what could happen to the property. They might be open to some sort of tenure arrangement that would be long-term enough where they could have another farmer rent the land in a long-term agreement and, you know, bring in, or you know, even in within their own family, like maybe their grandchildren or something are to the age that they're interested in kind of experimenting on the farm. So if that individual, that generation, can encourage the landowner who's aging that, you know, let me try something out on a few acres of the farm, you know, this few acres that you don't use that much anyway. I think those are some entry points potentially for that.
Now let me pick up, I think, on similar ones. When we talk about bridging the gap, for example, with agriculture and forestry, it seems to me that landowners are most likely to adopt something that because we heard from Jacob this morning where what his father did and what he wants to do are almost 180 degrees. And so that's unusual that can occur. We in Missouri are really high on the potential to integrate silvopasture as an add-on practice to the large amount of folks that grow, have cow-calf operations in Missouri. However, to go from somebody that doesn't do managed intensive rotational grazing to silvopasture, that's a huge stretch. But for 20 years, the state has offered grazing schools that teach landowners who are interested in cow-calf operations about managed intensive grazing. So that's our target. Our target is to say, you do managed intensive rotational grazing, you have a woodlot that you aren't even using, surprise, there's an opportunity to create new paddocks and manage your forest and make money in the long term off your forest management. In the meantime, you're immediately increasing the size of your acreage for more production and also improving animal health, and there's all kinds of benefits. trying to look at where people might be already inclining towards something and then move them further along that path. In terms of almost everywhere, we face the dilemma about I'm located in Southeast Indiana or Northwest Iowa or somewhere, anywhere in the Midwest, and I don't have a support infrastructure. So one of the things that we've tried to do is we've created, and others have created, short courses. So we have been trying to train the trainers, try to train NRCS folks and extension folks and landowners to get them up to some modicum of knowledge in agroforestry. And then if the landowners are going into those county offices and talking to, for example, NRCF folks that have had exposure, they're much more likely to try to help them make it work and not say, no, we don't do that. So we have to work on this from all perspectives, and part of that issue is an education issue for people that are in a position to collaborate with the landowner. Last thing I want to say is, if we know the market value of crops, landowners are much more likely to try alternative practices that are, I call, market-based conservation. I think a lot of our programs, like Conservation Reserve, that you put money in, the crop prices go up, you rip them out, we've got nothing. But if the practice that's put in is some form of agroforestry practice, for example, multi-species riparian buffer, all the species within the buffer actually have market value, and the landowner is going to continue to manage that, contract or no contract. And so I think if the market dictates what you're doing, then it's not going to come and it's not going to go.
That's precisely the argument I've been making for 25 years. question about focusing or specializing is the one I'll address first. I think it's important to pick the low-hanging fruit first, and then once that's picked, then you can start reaching higher. And in my opinion, that low-hanging fruit, as far as agroforestry, is chestnuts. That's what's relatively easy to grow, has a very broad range of area where it can be grown, and it's easy to sell. The market is there already, always has been. For 5,000 years it's been there, and that's the place to start. How do we educate NRCS? That's a challenge. NRCS offices are extremely diverse. There are very much Farm Bureau type people in some of those offices, and in others, they're very open people. And several years ago, I got a call from a district conservationist from Southern Indiana who, well, was interested in getting landowners in his county to plant chestnuts. And he did. He got a couple of people to do that. And just as recently as yesterday, I got a call from a landowner in Southern Indiana wanting more information about planting chestnuts. So it is happening out there. Maybe not in your county, but it's out there. As far as bridging the gap between agriculture and forestry, as I said, my goal is to provide an example of how agroforestry can be the most profitable part of the farm, even on the very best quality land. But as a practical matter, we do have to start with the odd corners and the marginal land, because that's where people are going to be willing to try it out first, and then we can move towards the better land. And it's also going to also have to start not with large corn and soybean farmers, but with the small holders, people who have 1 to 10 or 15 acres or so, doctors, lawyers, and dentists, and college professors. those are the ones who are gonna be open to agroforestry. The corn and bean farmers are harvesting corn and beans at the time when the other things, the agroforestry crops, need to be harvested, and they just don't have time for that. But if we can supply an example of somebody earning more money on 10 acres than a corn and bean farmer is doing on 2,000 acres, the laws of supply and demand are going to push toward agroforestry. I don't even know enough about finance to be dangerous, so I'll pass on those topics.
So some of my thoughts on those questions. As far as the specialization and the support networks, I think that people need to choose a crop that they're gonna have a majority of, for sure. I know that diversity is the key to healing the soil and the water, so I really like diversity, but yeah, I would definitely advise our clients to choose one or two crops, and those are the ones that we're gonna do the business plans on, and the 5, 7, 10, 20 succession plans on. You just have to, I think, if you are going to make a profit as a farmer. If you're doing agroforestry on the side for land that doesn't need to pay for itself, then that's fine. You don't have to choose. You can be super, super diverse. So the windbreaks, those marginal lands, the odd bits, those are also where you can kind of really go crazy on the diversity, I think. I also think those are bridges for a lot of corn and soy monoculture farmers. What we try to do on our designs is fit the design to the landscape, to the lifestyle that that person is. So if they like to ride tractor all day, then we're going to figure out agroforestry ways that they can continue to ride tractor all day, but in a perennial way. So how is that? So you need to know your social biome, you need to know your personal biome. And that's the way that I think, you know, transitioning large-scape, large lands from corn and bean, that's how I'm going about it. You have to know who that person is, who their family is, for it to be successful in the long term. The aggregating and the hubs is where I think the specializing really comes into key. So if you have a few different crops, that's awesome, but you need to find your other peeps that have those same crops, and then you're able to really specialize in the industry, what Rahe is referring to, aggregating these larger industries in which you can get attract larger investors, right? Most of the people that we work with, you know, have 50 to 150 acres. You know, 500 is big for us that I've been working with right now. And so as we increase those, being able to transition larger lands, a lot of it has to do with aging farmers, okay? So we really have to address the social biome of why this is happening. And if someone comes that's 50 or 60 years old and wants to get into agroforestry, we have to really think about, well, how do you want to live your days? And then that's gonna transition to what your crop design is and how you're gonna deal with that. I'm super lucky to be in the upper Midwest with very open-minded NRCS offices and soil and water conservation districts who've been excellent partners and given lots of money to the farmers that I've worked with. That being said, I know that that's not the same across the nation. Ray Archuleta is my favorite NRCS officer, and he's open to being invited to two other NRCS officers, offices around the nation. So if you do have issues with conservative or old paradigm NRCS people, all of the current publications, lexicon of NRCS is extremely supportive of regenerative agriculture. And so some of the times they just don't simply have the most updated thing. But Ray Archuleta, and sometimes he tours around with Gabe Brown from Brown's Ranch in North Dakota, they're amazing. And they have their data and their science, and they have a nice NRCS name tag on there that really helps the other officers get up to speed with where we're headed. Easiest ways to bridge forest and ag in cooperative nature. When I talk to someone who sprays a lot of glyphosate on their land and I'm trying to figure out a way that I can get on their same page. They care about having a healthy farm and family. Everyone does, no matter how they're farming. And so to find those values that connect us all, and water and soil connect us all. So when you talk about how to have a healthier, more productive farm that makes more money, you're going to have healthier water and soil cycles, no matter how you farm. And so that's usually the bridge that I start with for people. The inherent nature of alley cropping and silvopasture is cooperative design. And so being able to integrate maybe younger farmers or different farmers that want to run animals or grow vegetables for immediate cash flow in the especially 3 to 5 establishment years time while the other perennials are growing, that's inherently a cooperative forest and ag model. And so we could have really wide alleys. You know, we could have 160 feet alleys if we want, depending upon who you're going to invite to the farm. And so the options are limited only by our creativity with alley cropping and silvopasture, I think. So the real estate investor model, I'm gonna actually let you speak to it, but I've seen a lot of failures and we're still, you know, just kind of pushing the edge of the new financial world, I think, in perennials. I just came from the Quivira conference in New Mexico a week ago, and we had a lot of West Coast investors, and water is obviously in high demand in the Southwest, so they're a little bit ahead of us in terms of drought-proofing and larger landscapes and moving forward with that, and so they have different kinds of investors in California. But this is increasing, and a lot of their business plans that they were talking about were based on ecosystem services. So, you know, that's when I come back to, for me, you know, drought proofing is flood proofing. So I'm more into flood proofing where I live. With that amount of water that we're getting, whether it's 30 inches a year or whatever, you know, I'm thinking in my head, okay, 1 inch of rain on an acre is gonna be 27,000 gallons of water or something. 1% of organic matter increase in my soil is going to hold 16,500 something acre or inches of water, gallons of water. Okay, so 1% increase in soil organic matter can hold 16,000 gallons of water. So when I'm thinking about as our extreme climate increases and food security, I'm going to be focusing on the soil and the water systems, and I think any farmer is going to want to be into that no matter what they're growing.
So I'll speak briefly just to that question of support networks and how we grow support networks. And for me, I think it's something that's happening, I mean, just as these guys said, like from the bottom up, there's some work that's being done from the top down. And then I just think it's a continuous process, right? And so I think it's really important to take advantage of the folks who may be nearby who you don't know. So I guess, you know, Savannah Institute has done a lot of great work developing this perennial map concept, and that's something that I think in the agroforestry community, it's something we've wanted for a long time to try and say, you know, I get calls every day saying, I'm in this location, who's a farmer near me who's doing it? And, you know, there's a limit to the number of people I can hold in my head or my coworkers can hold in their head. So it's so amazing to have a resource where you can start to be like, okay, let's pull this up. I'm not gonna know everybody. So adding yourself to that, thinking about that, using that as a resource, I think will help us, again, develop that support network among growers, among technical service providers, among researchers. I think, you know, the more that we can grow these agroforestry working groups, the MOG that was talked about earlier, if folks want to contribute to that, be a part of that, share through that, that's, I think, another network we need to look to that's bringing together these different sectors who are excited about agroforestry and sharing that way. A lot of us have been involved in the education efforts that Mike referenced around trying to invite people who have these roles with conservation districts or have these roles with NRCS who honestly don't get a lot of opportunities to, I mean, there are a lot of people who work, I've found, who are really, really excited about this stuff, have a job with NRCS, but they don't get the chance to get that education to learn about new things. And it comes, they're able to advocate for themselves to get that education when they're getting requests from producers. So if somebody at NRCS is getting all these requests about alley cropping, and they're sometimes calling us at the National Agroforestry Center, but more often saying, gosh, I don't know this, their supervisor. Well, then maybe their supervisor is going to let them attend Mike's Agroforestry Academy or some of the other educational opportunities that are out there. So I guess not to put it back on producers by any means, but I just think that's an important piece of that puzzle of getting folks more oriented towards agroforestry and all of these other practices. I think too, just as an awareness thing, I guess there is work that we try and get involved with, or my director tries to get involved with, on the top-down side of things. At USDA, there's an interagency agroforestry team, so just trying to expand awareness of agroforestry to some of these other key agencies who are maybe have a role in the other parts of the supply chain beyond just the establishment phase, right? Like we were talking about the importance of having somebody to sell to, you know, working through cooperatives, all these things. And USDA has a role in that and in so many other parts of agriculture. And so we're trying slowly but surely to try and have that awareness come from the top down. And so we get to do things occasionally like, submit USDA blog posts that reference agroforestry. I try and insert things into the all NRCS internal newsletter related to agroforestry. And so not saying it's there, not saying that's going to fix it all, but I think we really need to think about those solutions coming from all different directions. So.
So we started our company 11 years ago in the middle of a financial crisis, and investors, I think, didn't trust anybody at that point in time. And we knew the farmers wouldn't trust us. So we thought, well, why not get into a business where nobody trusts anybody and see what you can make out of it. Now we use rollover IRA accounts. So I can tell you that the company started business with IRAs because we were able to convince individuals that investing in sustainable agriculture, regenerative agriculture, you know, agroforestry, et cetera, you know, was a good place for some of their IRA money. And so when we formed the Real Estate Investment Trust earlier this year, it was really just a sneaky way of getting people more IRA funds, you see. So I'm speaking about the long-term plan here. But there's a huge amount of capital that has to come in here. And it really is a long-term plan to try to get a piece of everybody's IRA. Very few people, when you ask them, well, how's your farmland portfolio doing? You know, they just look at you blindly, right? So we know that there's an awful lot of people that haven't yet invested in this big, huge opportunity. But don't be fooled, Real Estate Investment Trust, there still isn't any trust. I mean, we went out of our way to incorporate, I think we're the first real estate investment trust that's incorporated as a public benefit corporation. And we're proud of that. And the public benefit is the public health. And it's all about healthy soils and waters and secure long-term land access so that this can be accomplished. But you know, the big challenge was creating an entity that could hold indefinitely. You know, we didn't take, we knew that this would be a big challenge because most capital wants to come in just with a short-term time horizon. So in order to gain the trust of the farmers, you know, we said, well, here we're gonna really stick it to the investors. Our investors didn't have an exit for the first 7 years. So we told, we told the investors, here's what you're gonna do. You're gonna buy stock in this company. You don't know when you're gonna get your money back, but you know, trust us. We're going to develop a business that is economic and actually has an exit at some point in time. But you're going to have to trust that we're going to do that. And by the way, if we don't build the trust of the farmers, this ain't going to work anyway. So then we went to the farmers and we told them what this capital, the terms of the capital was coming in, and nobody believed us that could actually, you could actually get somebody to invest without an exit plan. And so we began to build the trust of the farmers, but on the investment side, you know, people put their money into all kinds of crazy things. Everybody knows this. A lot of you in this room probably have investments in stuff that you don't even know what it is or how it works or even perhaps the full name of the company. So we knew that money would flow in. But over the long term, the farmers do have to make a profit. So I'm just speaking to one of the questions had to do about profits. But once again, the key was to give the farmers enough time to develop an economic business. We started doing mortgages recently too, not because we really wanted to be a mortgage company, but the terms of the loans from conventional financial world are really based on an extractive view of the land. And whereas we take a more regenerative view, so we'll do interest only for the first 5 years, just as an example, for a mortgage, because how can you possibly be healing the soil and at the same time paying amortization back to the bank? I mean, it's just a complete mismatch. And, you know, so there's little ways of changing finance that can be very sustainable for the business. And hopefully what we're seeing is that after 5 years or so, and as part of a long-term transition to a diverse, you know, food business plan, that that farmers are becoming profitable. But it's a very long-term focus. I don't think there's any way around it. This change has to happen. So we'll continue to try to train the capital to be patient and support that.
And just for the record, my jaw is still way down here from understanding how Eco Valley Farms work, because I never really thought. I got a lot of background in financial training and management and stuff, and I never thought anybody was ever going to understand what David just went through. Anyway, so two things about finances. There is one thing, which is what David talked about, and then there is the conventional financing, which is a whole nother story. But the third element that I think is critical in creating the financial infrastructure is farms being financiable, meaning there's a good business plan, it's solid, there's infrastructure, there is risk management, there is all kinds of things like that already in place. And that, in my experience, is missing for most of the farms I have visited. I studied 250 farms before we started our engineering process. And in those 250 farms, I found everything except business sense. Great, great operations, very excited people. I mean, all of them muddy, but very little business sense. And I was not interested in doing that. I spent my whole childhood and my young adult life laboring in farms for pennies a day. And I was not interested in work. I was interested in output and results and value. And that's a very different approach. When you're interested in that, you create businesses out of farming that are very different and that also are more financeable than many of the things we see out there. So keep that in mind. Specializing, again, we can't build a poultry processing facility for 2 or 3 or 4 million chickens, which is the basic bottom line to actually even run a minor, you know, an operation that is barely gonna break even if everybody's raising 25, 100, 75, or 200 chickens. Don't work that way. Even if there was enough farmers to do that, trying to bring all of that together is a waste of time. It doesn't make business sense either. And so we just gotta talk, you know, like business people as well as committed farmers. I do a few chickens on my own place. That's for my family consumption, all that. I'll never argue that that's how you build an industry. Also, branding, for example, it requires standardization. You can't put a brand on things that are coming from different practices. And branding is where we lose control and ownership of our products, because someone else comes, sets up a brand, and then comes over and controls what we do on the farm. And that's a very important piece in terms of thinking about ourselves as part of an industry rather than an industry that comes and works, that we work for. See, ownership and control to us is the first step in how you engineer not only the farming process, but the business development process. Educating those folks at NRCS and so on, I have to say we have been very successful at that. And the reason isn't because it's only because we are not trying to convince them of anything. We're just showing them in the terms that they understand. We're not trying to have them change so that they can understand us. We took everything we're doing and interpreted for them in the terms they understand. That's a very different approach. And because of that, they don't feel like we're criticizing them, we're blaming them or anything like that. In fact, that now they are seeing us as one of those productive conservation easements in Dakota County, in the farm which is put through, and Lindsay and her partner Paula are working on that process with Dakota County so that farmers will be paid to put our system into their farms. In the same round, we just had the third meeting with the NRCS in Rice County, which is south of that. If we can convince those two counties, we can produce 100% of all of the eggs and all of the meat that Minnesota consumes with those two counties alone. Now, if we achieve that, the whole country changes. That's how you build industries. Now, in how you educate people who are not gonna come to you unless they see that they don't have a choice. The gap, let's do that very quickly, because our engineering process is not at all like the conventional agriculture engineering. I'm a conventionally trained agronomist. Yet, when we started developing this system, we looked at it from an energy standpoint. And if we understand what a farmer actually does, rather than what we think we do, then you start understanding farming a whole different way. Keep in mind that farmers don't produce products. That's not what we do. We produce nutrition. And to produce nutrition, you don't manage inputs and outputs. You manage energy transformation. And there is no place on earth where energy transformation happens more efficiently than where there is permanent agroforestry systems in place. Why? Because that's how biosystems operate. And when you think of energy as the foundation of your business equation and your branding and all of that and your farming practices, what happens is, like in our case, we now are about 1 year from completely eliminating all of the inputs, and it will allow us to produce eggs, meat, hazelnuts, elderberries, vegetables like garlic, onions, sprouts, most of the leafy vegetables, all of those with zero outside inputs, including, and this we're talking about inputs and energy management, whether it's organic or synthetic, it doesn't matter, because you pay for the energy that comes into the farm. And as we decide with energy flows in mind, as we engineer, we also minimize the amount of effort and the amount of labor and the amount of cost. And that is the foundation for a good business plan on a farm. That's how we engineer. So whenever you have time, check the specs of everything we do, and you will find that everywhere. Even the height of the nests are made so that the farmer can actually collect those eggs mechanically, because at that point, there's no need to be bending over and carrying baskets and things like that. Are we going to be done very soon here? Because I got like five more points. For us, poultry is a bridge to agroforestry. You can't wait 5 years before you can harvest something. You will die of starvation or something else. Coming from a place where we actually grew up hungry and everything, I can tell you, I myself will not plant a hazelnut and then sit there and wait for my 20 acres or whatever for 5 years before I can see a nut. By the way, in the conditions that hazelnuts or perennial crops are being supplied right now, you will go broke just by buying them in the first place. So combined with the fact that we have to have a bridge, poultry, for example, 80 days after you finish your poultry unit, you have production, and you have production in excess of 8 to 10 times what a corn and soybean grower is going to do per acre right away. And meanwhile, those animals raise your perennial crop. We are now on year 8 of doing that, and we are producing 1 pound of actual kernels in average over the last 3 years per bush, as compared to 0.3 pounds, that is the average in the Midwest. And Norm Erickson is here, and he's been one of our suppliers. And the plants he supplied, which are categorized to produce about 0.33 pounds of kernels per bush, those same plants are producing 1 pound for us. That's 3 point something times more because of the poultry, because we manage energy, not production, not outputs and stuff like that. So that's critical. But then the other part of it is that financing perennials may have little to do with money and more about cooperation. So for example, we built probably the largest nursery right now of elderberry cloning garden, and we are now capable of giving out well over 60,000 cyanwood pieces every spring. We don't want money for that. We just want farmers to come harvest them and plant them. That's how we start reproducing perennials, because the establishment cost is the reason most farmers are not getting perennials on their land. Put aside all of the other cultural issues, when they change, the thing that keeps them from doing it is the cost. Hazelnuts, we're doing the same. We're now planting every year as many hazelnuts as we can so that farmers can just have them and move them into their fields. Why? Because the hazelnut is not the center of our operation, it's poultry. So poultry allows us to deploy large-scale production of perennials, and by the way, they produce tremendous value for the farmer as well. You know, one of those pounds of kernels sells for about $20 a pound once it's cleaned and all of that. And we are producing one per bush at 600 bushes per acre. You do the math, that's serious money 4 years later.
Okay, thank you all very much for those responses. So I'm afraid we don't have time for another round of questions, but what I'd like to do in closing is ask each of you to think a little bit creatively. And each of you have described what you're doing, and it's, I think, for all of us, inspiring and encouraging and useful work. But you've all each described wanting to do more, wanting to see more of these high nutritional value crops planted in Illinois, or silvopasture in Missouri, or chestnuts in Iowa throughout the region. And it goes on. We see the opportunity for more. And so for some of you, you've said this already, and so maybe it's just synthesizing it, but what do you think is that key limitation that's keeping us from more? And what do you see for somebody, either one of your shared panelists or elsewhere in the room, or perhaps it doesn't exist yet, that might be a key leverage point for overcoming that limitation? And I guess we'll follow the same pattern here, Sarah, if I can put you on the spot again.
Okay, I think the first thing that comes to mind for me is how difficult it is to compete with alternative crops in a market system that's so driven toward corn and soybeans and so subsidized. And one aspect I think that could be managed a lot better is the insurance aspect. So a lot of corn soybean growers benefit a lot from going ahead and planting corn and soybeans in those marginal areas or areas that flood, knowing that they can get insurance payments for that. So if there was a way for the system to change so that even small crops, specialty crops, could benefit from those same insurance aspects, particularly since the investment up front is greater. And so the need for insurance is greater, I think, in those situations. So that's the one piece I would think.
One thing that's very important from, at least from a university perspective, and it's difficult to achieve, and that's staying power. So if you're going to do work on long-term perennial crops, you can't invest in research for 5 years and stop. You just aren't going to know enough. Fortunately, we've been in Missouri, we've had 20 years of activity, so we are now actually seeing the fruits, the nuts of the labor, because we've actually done the work, so that when we recommend something, we actually know that it's viable. I understand that you can get into chickens in 80 days, right? And you have to wait all these years to get into hazelnut. But actually, in the ideal world, you're also going to be working with an improved hazelnut and not just working with some random bunch of who knows what kind of germplasm, where some's good and a lot of them are dogs. So if you have the university long-term collaboration, then ultimately when you put that future system in, every part of your system is going to be a winner to the optimum degree.
Again, the single biggest hurdle to adopting the agroforestry food systems is that time lag. Well, not only just a time lag, but an upfront investment in labor and capital for at least several years before you see the first return, and that's a hurdle that's will keep most people from ever adopting. You have to have some way to not only keep busy, but keep busy profitably, such as maybe with chickens, until you get that first return.
Mighty chicken.
What's that?
The mighty chicken.
The mighty
yes.
chicken.
The limitations that I see, absolutely, Farm Bill, you know, we have major systematic infrastructure issues in the United States that support monoculture farming and spraying of herbicides, insecticides. So yeah, the Farm Bill is a big thing. I go to DC, I will testify, I've been part of USDA panels supporting farmers and trying to bring information there, but that's the long slog. I have much more urgent concerns, and so we want to change the land now. And so when working with the people, with DC aside, working with people in the Midwest, I see a lot of social issues in terms of getting along. So if we're gonna be, you know, healing the landscapes, it heals ourselves. And if we're gonna be planting perennial plants, we need to have perennial relationships. Long-term community relationships is a success factor. When I look at the hubs that are succeeding, it's because they have good community networks, diverse social networks. And so that's very important to me. One example of that, you know, and being able to make it fun, but also being able to be like, oh crap, a frac sand mine is coming into my neighborhood. I need a network, not just a network that's gonna support me for planting trees in my pasture or running animals through my veggie fields. I need a larger network for other life issues. So strengthening our community networks is one of the most important things, I think. The plants and ecological design is the easy part to me. And so we just had an aronia party, and it was super fun. Lily Springs Farm in Osceola, Wisconsin, they harvested their first crop of aronia, and we invited chefs and makers of all kinds. So diversifying, they were not farmers that came to this party. So just that is a key thing in diversifying. People have skills that you don't have that could increase your markets and your networks. And everyone had to make a different thing with the aronia. And then we shared it. And we also had like this large roasted lamb from a local farmer too. And it just doing something like that to be like, oh, okay, yeah, we're actually gonna partner on this product now together. We're gonna make it together with this restaurant. That's super exciting. Tangible, productive outcomes came out of like a social fun thing around a perennial product. And just leveraging, particularly leveraging the elders with the young. That's very important to me. Who has land, like Joel Salatin says, the old farmers can't get out. The new farmers can't get in if the old farmers can't get out. And so being able to connect our cycles, our multi-generational cycles, is one of the biggest leverage points I see.
I think I would also say that the social piece is so huge, and I think maybe that comes from having the opportunity in my work to get to the country and see so much exciting agroforestry work going on. And I spend a lot of time trying to connect people and trying to build those networks. I think it's especially obviously effective and important to do that on a smaller scale, but I think we need to think about it across different scales as well. And so just trying to think of innovative ways to do that information sharing, to make it fun and make it exciting, but also just make sure that we're connecting people in ways that are really effective.
So we say eat healthy and invest in what you eat. And if you do those two things, you change the world. Is that not easily done, of course? So we feel, well, we're very optimistic. I mean, we see that the next generation of farmers are changing agriculture. We are compelled to engage, we think, the next generation of investors. We've been confined for 11 years now. Looking at a confinement operation here, we've been confined to accredited investors, you know, defined by the SEC as those worthy of putting their money into small ventures. So we want to break out of that confinement. We want to give millennial investors, the next generation, smaller investors, the ability to invest in this change. So that's something we're very much committed to, and we think, because we're optimistic that the next generation really gets it, we think that's what will change agriculture. Mm.
To us, the biggest barrier really is culture. The culture that defines food as cheap, farmers as backwards, or people, you know, who don't belong in civilized society. Researchers that never move to production because they have to keep researching. That's a culture that we have to resist to. The inability for small farmers to think big, and I don't mean big farms, I mean big systems of small farms. All of those elements of the culture that has on one hand been imposed, and on the other hand we have nurtured and developed, in sometimes in resistance to what has been imposed on us. Those elements of our culture are really what is getting at the core of us being wildly successful in the Midwest. In Guatemala, for example, but we don't have those barriers, or in Mexico. In Guatemala, we had 2,000 farmers show up to a meeting that we announced 2 months before that. We now have 4 regions that are already mapped out, and already large companies that are investing. Like, this is within 1 year. Even, you know, Pepsi Cola is coming in with capital that they are, you know, having trouble placing in other industries. It's nothing because they believe they just need to put capital in new ideas. And they are picking this also because we could supply them with some raw materials and so on. In Mexico, the same thing. We have 300 farmers now that are part of our San Miguel de Allende operation in Guanajuato. I can only dream of doing that in this culture that we live in this country. People are not ready for change. Maybe we need to starve for a couple of years before we're ready. Maybe that's what's gonna take. I don't know, but the Midwest is probably the only place that has the most amazing opportunities to be the leader in the world in food production from perennial systems, and we're squandering that by tiling our lands as if somehow that's gonna put us in a competitive advantage 10, 15 years from now. I mean, that entrepreneurial myopia, in our case as farmers, were part of that problem of that culture. For example, I've been told that hazelnuts are not even enough yet to plant them in the industrial level and all that. Well, that's only if we think in terms of linear ways like soy and corn. But for example, the first thing we figured out was that we don't even need to process them. We can actually develop the US-based Iberico pork in the middle nuts are uneven. We can also sort them out now, and we get over that hump, and now we can extract oil. Well, guess what? The next thing was, well, we're gonna sell them. They're not food grade. I said, who said we wanna sell them? We want to eliminate soybeans as a source of the food for our poultry. That is 70% of the total cost of raising poultry. Who says we need to sell them in order to actually make it highly profitable? Sometimes it's about not selling the best idea, because not selling allows us to not buy, especially soybean, which is the highest price component of 70% of the cost of raising poultry. I mean, like, that's the kind of stuff we are frustrated with, because it is a culture that has conditioned us to think so close to our face that we can't see the larger opportunity. That's what I want to break out today.
Thanks to all our panelists. Provide any synthesizing remarks, because I won't attempt that. So thank you all so much for sharing today. And I hope you'll all be able to stay and hear what we have to hear from folks who want to share during our nutshell session this afternoon. On that note, let me remind you that if you would like to give a nutshell presentation, you're very welcome to, and we hope you will. If you have slides or photos that you would like to share that you haven't given to us already, we'll have someone here at this black computer who can help you upload those from a thumb drive, or if you have them on the cloud or whatever it is, and get those all up for everyone. 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 Those all.